Dr. Swamy, thank you very much for speaking to us. So we're trying to understand what and whether you have a vision for young Indians. But before we do that, let me ask you something. What are you exactly? Are you a good cop, a bad cop, a maverick, a troublemaker? Because we're not able to make out.
Well, I think it depends on the situation. If I see a crook, I will be a troublemaker.
Okay.
If I see a gentleman, I'll be one of the most civilized persons that you can see, erudite. It depends on the circumstances you are in. And people who see me in one particular circumstance then extrapolated that to the total personality, which is not true. So when they see Maverick, there also I find if you express an independent opinion, then you're a Maverick. But if you don't express an independent opinion, they will go on pestering you. What about this man who's corrupt in your party? Why don't you speak about him? If I do, they'll say he's a maverick, he's speaking against his own party.
Right. And the reason I'm asking this is, you know, when young people today, and we're talking about first-time voters, enter the realm where they will choose their candidates, the chances are that what they will encounter is confusion, right?
Yes.
And that's sometimes exacerbated by the media onslaught that we're seeing today. Yeah. And you're actually part of that.
Yeah.
Right, because you're there on TV every other night, you're taking positions on a whole bunch of issues. So I come back to the first point that I made. It creates and perhaps accentuates confusion.
That would be a problem only if the youth wanted to be like somebody else. I say, don't ever fall into that trap. There's no such thing as a role model. Everybody has different circumstances. And therefore, you decide what you want to do. And then don't look this way, that way, don't get persuaded. Never do something because somebody says this is what you should do. You can listen to a lot of people, but ultimately, you have to make the decision yourself. If you do that, there'll be no confusion.
So let me rewind then, right? So we know a certain Dr. Subramanian Swamy, fashioned media images, positions taken on a variety of issues, and very diverse. If I were to rewind, take you back, why did you enter politics?
I entered politics for a very simple reason. I came back to this country and I advocated market economy. The prevailing opinion with people like Mr. Arunmathyasen and others was that it was a left-wing environment. The Soviet Union had enormous influence. And they saw me as a threat. And as a consequence, I was fired from my full professorship at the Indian Institute of Technology. Because I won the case afterwards.
And you went, you reinstated.
Not reinstated, they said that it was as if there was no order passed at all. It was such an illegal order. But by then I had become a cabinet minister, so I could not return back to teaching. So I had entered politics because the choice was either go back to America and start teaching at Harvard again, or stay in India and do something else. And the only opening that time was politics. So that's how I entered.
So you said, so politics was an accidental career move?
It was a compulsion of the situation because there was no other way I could survive in India. Because I couldn't get another job.
The answer people would look for is because you wanted to serve the country, you wanted to bring about change, you wanted to...
I always wanted to bring a change. When I was a professor, I wanted to shift from socialism to market economy. And therefore, I ran into trouble. So anyway, politics was the platform by which I could do propagate much better. But I came into politics, I would have preferred to have been a professor all my life.
What's the common thread behind most of the actions that you pursue today? And many of them are in court, of course.
Well, I fight illegality, I fight injustice. And once I take it up, I go all the way. And naturally, the people are hurt by it. They say all sorts of, ascribe all sorts of motives, say all kinds of things.
So there are obviously, I mean, I'm not trying to ascribe motives, but there are some kinds of cases you pick up and there are maybe others you don't.
Yes, I do.
So what's the method?
The method is this, that I have a limitation of time. And if I'm not in power, I don't even have resources, limited resources. So in order to meet the standards of proof in any endeavor, whether it's academic or the courts or any other, I have to put in a lot of effort. So I take the view that if someone is my associate and is corrupt, it's not my job to expose him. Because he has opponents. They should be exposing him. I will oppose those who are opposed to me or are blocking me or are hurting me. those are the people I will concentrate on. So it's a question of having necessity to make choices, because I have that limitation of resources, time,
right,
and the requirements of evidence.
Right. So you're now you're poised to enter active politics again, and you will start campaigning in Delhi. Now, you'd obviously have to present yourself as a different person, right? Not someone who's only been, a voter wants to know, presumably, what you will do for them, what you will do for the country. And the young voter particularly wants to know, where will jobs come from? Where is the security going to come from?
I don't agree with you.
Mm.
My image is already made.
Mm-hmm.
Fighter against corruption.
Okay.
Propagator of Hindutva.
Okay.
Strong action against those who mess with the country from abroad.
Mm.
So there are certain...
So images. All that is good, but is that enough
that
to...
That is enough. That's what people are looking for. There is a thirst for an assertion of India's individuality.
Mm-hmm.
People want to know who we are.
Mm.
I have written about it, I've propagated about it. What is India's true identity? The youngsters accept that, particularly because...
So tell us a little more about that then.
Well, I think we are a continuing civilization, and that Hindu civilization is dominant to Hindu civilization. But the beauty of Hindu civilization is that it allows everybody to practice their own approach to God.
Mm.
And that means including other religions. There's no other religion in the world
which
gives you that freedom. In a Islamic country, you try and propagate Hinduism, you are dead.
Right.
In Christianity, they will call you devil's disciple.
Right.
So I would say that India has to recover its original culture.
Mm-hmm.
And that is endeavor, full endeavor, that the religion teaches you that you have freedom of action. The fruits of that action will come in haphazard way, not necessarily linearly related to your effort.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you can put in a lot of effort and get nothing. Sometimes you sit at home and the thing drops in your lap.
Right. But you said you don't agree with me.
It was my attempt to define what Young India, I think, wants. No. But I don't think there's any confusion.
Mm-hmm. Or no contradiction.
Or a contradiction. I have seen that in Twitter.
Mm.
Well, large, I have a following, genuine followers, not people from Turkey or anything like that. I have almost 500,000 followers.
Mm.
They're all young people. I've held a Twitter conference, different parts of India.
Yeah.
So they're interacting with me. There are people sending me emails. There are people who come to meet me. I think the one thing is that they appreciate is that there is clarity of personality. There's no doubt where I stand on anything.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they appreciate. So when you say people are saying, no, I'm not a new person, I'm a well-known person.
Oh, exactly.
The emergency, I have a record which is unparalleled when fighting it.
Mm-hmm.
I've written articles which I was vindicated, whether it's a relation, normalization of relations with China or Israel or economic reforms, which in fact I was the first one to prepare the blueprints. So I think this particular aspect is not the problem. Everybody knows me.
Okay.
Who read newspapers, who listen to televisions, and so on.
Hmm.
So I think so that is not the problem.
Let me then frame the question differently.
Yeah,
what is Young India, according to you, looking out for? And more importantly, what will deliver to their aspirations and desires?
They want to know how to design their life
in
such a way that they are happy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, see, even in the Western countries today, they're coming to our sadhus and sannyasis and ashrams. You go to Ramdev's or Sri Sri Ramachandra, you see so many foreigners, all very well-to-do foreigners.
Hmm.
And in the United States, there are all these sadhus have opened ashrams and they are flocking people, yoga and so on. I think this is the key thing that the youngsters are looking. How should I design my life or focus my life, and how do I deal with problems of life? So I begin by saying, first of all, that nothing is more enriching in life than taking risk.
Mm-hmm.
And the British taught us, play safe.
Mm-hmm.
The most damaging thing for your life is to play safe.
When you say risk, you mean entrepreneurial kind of risk? Or
anything.
Okay.
You see, supposing I say, I come from a family of lawyers.
Mm.
And I say, no, I want to be a doctor. Now there will be consternation in the family. Say, you know, everything is ready-made for you. What are you doing? or I want to be a business management graduate, or I want to be an artist, I say, go by what your instinct tells you. It doesn't matter if you end up failure. Meet failure as a great educator.
Right. So, I mean, this is advice for the parents as well, as much as the... Yeah.
Not to expect their children that they must be top of the class by mugging. They must, you know, reason. So I would say taking risk in a way, in a calculated way, naturally, I'm not saying that you should take wild risks. If you are in a position to take wild risks, no problem. But you must learn to take risks. Don't play safe. Don't go for a career which means getting a salary and then retiring and watching television after that. Do something. Do, you know, be an innovator. We have a crude oil problem of importing from abroad. Find hydrogen fuel cells, or you convert, work on converting thorium into fissile uranium. You know, there are so many things.
Real problems that this country has.
Yeah. And think of doing something that I am making the world better than when I came in. That should be the focus.
And you were also saying that that's not how people of your generation were brought up.
No, my, when I was a young boy, was a career in National Defense Academy, become an army. That was one great career. IAS, IFS, which really meant, you know, just getting an annual increment in your salary, and at the end of that, a pension or a provident fund. I said, no, you stand on your own feet. Don't work for somebody else. Provide work for somebody else. That sort of an attitude. Yeah.
So that's what they should do. So that's what they should do. You're saying take risk, take leaps, even when you're young, and also equally telling them.
Do what you want to do.
Right. So,
and don't be afraid of failure. Failure is a great educator. But get up again. Don't get devastated. Then there are different kinds of intelligences. Now, we place too much emphasis on cognitive intelligence. But there's something called emotional intelligence, how you put across your views, how you can persuade the other person to come over to, you know, create followers, that is, so to speak. Then there is something called social intelligence, not to pursue your private interest in such a way that society is harmed. You can start a factory and pump evil smoke into the atmosphere. You may make profits, but the society will get health problems.
Right.
So then I would say that you must develop what is now called the spiritual intelligence, where you meditate and recognize that knowledge is in the cosmos. And for that, you need to develop a neural Wi-Fi which connects to this cosmos. And that can only be done by meditation, by yoga.
Well, I like the term neural Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
Use it with your permission.
Yeah, sure. So, but these are all now in the West recognized. Right. But it is there in the Vedas, it's there in the Upanishads.
Right. So take risks, cultivate emotional intelligence.
Yeah, multiple spiritual intelligence. There are seven multiple intelligences.
Yeah. So that's what I should do, or particularly if I'm representing young India here. What will you do for me?
Well, I have...
Not just if you were elected. I mean, that's one part.
When people come to me with problems, I teach them how to analyze the problems themselves. You know, I ask questions. There are a lot of people who write to me on Twitter about their problems. I ask them counter questions. Sometimes I give them a little knock, you know, don't be stupid. And it awakens them. But I think in the end, you know, you should not become dependent on anybody for solving your problems.
No, I don't mean problem solving. I'm saying, what's the vision? What's the direction?
Direction is that India is, you see, first of all, no country grows by merely having more capital and labor in the production process. You need innovation. The big difference between the situation when there was no railways and there are railways. Big situation, difference in situation between when there was no jet engines and now aircraft flying all over the world on jet engines. You see, there is a huge difference caused by internet. You have in one blow created a situation where you can run a corporation with the units in 27 countries sitting in one office,
right.
Video conferencing. So innovation is the key thing. And I would say that if you want to dedicate your life where you want to be remembered, not just somebody who came into this world and, you know, lived a normal life and died and forgotten forever, then I would say go for these innovations. Find out what the country's problems are and see how it can be liberated from that.
Mm-hmm.
Don't depend on the government.
Okay. But people would expect you to give a sense of what this government could be, what the political class could deliver.
What is the political class accountable for? Well, we will be presenting a fat volume on the vision for India, which the committee was headed by Nitin Gadkari. And I was a part of the chairman, a convener of a part of that committee called Economic Vision.
Okay. So that's his BJP, right? No, I'm saying even you as Dr. Swamy. It also comes back to my first question.
As I say to me, I have...
So you said resurgence of identity.
I could have stayed in Harvard all my life. And my teachers thought I would get the Nobel Prize. I came away after...
Because after the paper you authored with Samuelson. Yeah.
It was widely believed that in 5 years' time I'll get the Nobel Prize.
Yeah.
Samuelson himself told me, but in the end, you see, I thought that, no, I want to live in India. And when I came, I had hell here. It's the easiest thing for me to have done, pack up my bags and leave. Today, when I see my peers who thought I was nuts to go back, they say, you're right. We are now sitting in the park and feeding the birds. So, my life is, every moment is full of something or the other.
So, sense of purpose.
Yeah,
is very
I'm
important.
Doing something.
Yeah.
I'm relevant. Whereas in here, this kind of life, you had a absolute risk-free life. But then when you retired, you just become you cease to be relevant.
So let me ask you the concluding this thing. You know, I started out by saying that, what are you exactly?
Yeah,
and I think
you've
maybe thrown some light on it.
Yeah.
What will be the, I mean, what, as young India sort of
gets
into this, I mean, we're looking at another election, another season, new beginnings, whichever they are. What can young India expect? I mean, is it, is this, are we really ready for new beginnings? Is it going to be a continuation of the same?
Well,
where will you folks lead us?
I will focus on welding this society into a united society. And that I may put the country, if I am in a position to, put the country through fire. Even war, but I want this country to recognize its heritage, and I want everyone else to know that this is a country which nobody can mess with. That's what I would do. I'll put people through shocks, and then help them come out of it.
And can you illustrate one shock?
Well, if you were to deal with terrorism, you'll have to go to war. And for
like
that,
the US did.
Well, U.S. did not, that's not going to war.
They call it the war on terror.
No. They just landed in a country, and when more than 20 people per week started dying, they wanted to leave. Like they did in Vietnam, and now they're going to do in Afghanistan.
So what would you do?
I would say, no, if you think that there is an entity which is hostile to your country, you put an end to that country. As we know it, like the Americans did with Japan. You know, they really devastated that country, but then Japan became a new country. There I would say that don't compromise with evil.
But you're also effectively saying bomb your neighbors or bomb a neighbor.
I'm not asking them to bomb the neighbors without provocation. They must do something to you. And you'll get an opportunity, because the Taliban is in Pakistan is hell-bent on doing something to you. We have a country where 500,000 Kashmiri Pandits have been driven out from Kashmir. They are in refugee camps, large number of them.
But let me take you back. I mean, I'd love to engage with you on this point, but let me come back to what I started with. So you're saying that I should vote for you or vote for the BJP because
I'm not promising heaven.
Okay.
I'm promising,
but you're promising a version.
I'm promising you nation building, part in the nation building.
Okay.
This country has been.
But also, you're also promising shocks.
Absolutely. Be ready for shocks.
Sure.
It's possible that my mere threat might work. Then I'm ready for fighting back. So I don't know whether I have to go through a war at all. It's possible that.
But present a far stronger front than we've ever done before.
That
okay.
The assertion of the identity of India, which is a nation of Hindus and those others whose ancestors were Hindus. That's the identity of India.
Okay, and that's a statement that you've made in the past and been in a little bit of trouble for.
With the Italians here.
Correct. Anyway, that's not the objective of my conversation. So you're saying, as the self, be take risks.
Yes.
Build your seven intelligences.
Innovate.
Stand on your own feet. And from us, that's you.
Yes.
Look for direction to create a unified entity.
That's right.
In your case, you talk about Hindutva.
Yes.
As the unifying force.
If I can unite the Hindus, others will fall in.
And be prepared for shocks because we have to use this opportunity to be assertive.
There's no way of making an omelette without breaking the egg.
On that note, thank you very much, Dr. Swamy. Thank you.